Praise the Lord, and welcome to Contemporary Worship Service here at Largo Community Church. I am so happy to be in the place, in the house. We are actually here. So let me just tell you, I've got a few announcements before we get into the service. But let me just tell you, if you miss something or I miss something, you can always go to largocc.org. But let me first start with this. We are in the house every second and fourth Sunday. Yes, Contemporary Worship Service happens every second and fourth Sunday at 12:30. If you go to the website and click on Watch Live, you will check us out as we are praising and worshiping God. And of course, Minister Hooper will bring the word as he always does. And also, May the 6th, guess what's happening, guys? National Day of Prayer. We are going to do all kinds of praying and interceding on everyone's behalf, on our own, and together corporately. So check that out. Please go to the website because there's so many things going on at the church for May the 6th for National Day of Prayer. And also, the men's breakfast is Saturday, April the 17th at 9 a.m. Yes, we've got it going on with the men here too, as well as the women. They're going to have their fellowship breakfast on April the 24th at 10 a.m. Both of these are via Zoom, but let me just tell you, the men, they have a special guest, Dr. George, and I probably will butcher this. I apologize in advance. Dr. George Ego Asula will be talking about Am I My Brother's Keeper? So you don't want to miss it. But now let's go on into the service and check out Miss Kimmy as she goes ahead and prays for our service. Let's go now.
Thank you so much, Jocelyn, for bringing the announcement. We can't welcome you enough. So welcome and welcome again to our Contemporary Worship Service. It's always a pleasure to have you join us wherever you're streaming our service, from home, from work, from your car. Maybe you watched it way after during the week, but we're so happy that you could join us. It is always a pleasure. Before I go into the prayer, I wanted to just share a quick bit of what God put on my heart this morning. One of my favorite choir to listen to, especially on Sunday morning, is Maverick City Music. And they were singing this song, and it said, "Great is thy faithfulness." And it says, "Even in the storm, I would praise you." And see, that lyric really held true to my heart, because I started to think, like, dang, I serve a faithful God. Like, even in the storm, he's always faithful. He is true. His word is true. The God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is holy, and God is love. And so even when you're bringing your petition to God, even when God says, no, not right now, you say, delay is not denial. So even when God says, no, not right now, God is still faithful. His will always be done in our lives. And so I wanted to be in that spirit of just praising God, even when things don't go right, just still praising God, even when my prayers aren't answered yet, and just remembering how faithful and how true God really is. Please, let's bow our head as we go into the morning prayer. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to say thank you, Lord. We come with open hearts and open mouths just to say thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. Thank you for being true to who you are and who the Bible says that you are, Lord. Father, help us remember who you are and who we are in Christ, even when things don't go the way we want, even when things are stormy, even when we're going through a really bad storm. Help us to always remember who you are, Lord. Help us to remember your love for us, your unending love, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your favor in our lives, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for loving us even in times where we don't feel deserving of your love, Lord. Father, we commit this service into your holy hands, Lord. Father, we ask for the Holy Spirit to just come in our midst, Lord, wherever they're streaming this service, at home, at work, in their car. We ask for the Holy Spirit, Lord. Let them feel your presence, Lord. Encompass the room, Lord. Let us feel you, Lord. Father, we ask that you speak to us this morning, Lord. Father, we ask that that message touches our heart, Lord. Father, we pray for those who are struggling. Father, we pray for those who are in the valley right now, those people who are going through the storm, and they're just looking for something to lift their spirit. They're looking for that word to just lift their energy, Lord. Father God, let this be that word, Lord. Let the service and the sermon be that word that they're looking for, Lord. Help them renew their faith, Lord, and believe and trust in you even more, Lord. Father, we thank you for the praise team. We thank you for the choir. We thank you for those on the piano. We thank you for them, for the people operating the camera. We thank you for those who volunteer their time each and every Sunday to make this service work. We pray, oh Lord, that you just bless them, Lord. Bless their family, Lord. Bless the Largo Community Church, Lord. Bless every single person that just hears the sound of my voice and tunes into this service every Sunday. Father, we just want to worship you, Lord. Father, we're sinners, and a lot of times we sin and we come short of the glory of God, but thank you for salvation, and thank you for forgiving and cleansing all of our sins, Lord. And so we just ask for the forgiveness of sins, Lord. Father, we ask that you just make us whole, Lord. Father, we just worship you. My heart is full of so much gratitude, Lord. And I just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for in Jesus' mighty name that we have prayed. Amen. And now we're going to welcome our praise team as they bring the beautiful, beautiful sounds of worship.
Thank you, Kimmy. And good afternoon, Largo. Kimmy, that's one of my favorite songs also from Maverick City. And this week, I think it's with the spring and just with a lot of people getting vaccinated, my heart is just so thankful that we're on this side of the pandemic. Because last year this time, everyone was scared and we were shutting down. So that is my heart song, is just being thankful that we are on this side of the pandemic. So this afternoon, we're going to bless you with three songs. The first one is The Lion and the Lamb. And one of the first times I heard this song, it was at a Beth Moore conference, and with thousands of women singing this, I felt like we were in heaven. So I know it's not thousands of us here, but those that are here that are participating in the contemporary service, if you can sing the songs are on the mic, even if you just know the chorus, it's just so powerful. Talking about the lion, that Christ is resurrected, and the lamb, that he sacrificed so much for us, and he fights for us. He fights for us. Even when we don't even think he's fighting for us, he is fighting for us. And Easter isn't over, everyone. We can still sing about the resurrected Lord, because he is our Savior and he is still on the throne. Our next song that we're going to sing is Graves into Gardens, and we've sung this a couple of times, and I just love this because there's no one, nothing that can do anything that comes close to what God does for us, and I just love this song as well. And then we're going to end this with the blessing. We've sung this before, just a blessing into the spring season, a blessing over your family and your children and your household. So thank you. Blessings to you all.
It's coming on the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. Every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb, slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chain, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, so open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. Our God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with powers and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, 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 oh. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Stop the Lord. Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. The world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. D better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Thank you, praise team, for that wonderful, wonderful worship songs. I don't know about you, but I love a good worship songs, because even sometimes when you just don't have the words to say, the songs just help you, the lyrics. It's a sign of worship, a sign of thanksgiving. You can pray with a lot of these songs. And so I just thank you so much for that beautiful collection. And now let's go over to Nalis, who would talk about the prayer request and offering.
Thank you, Kimmy. And good afternoon to everyone. I just wanted to go through a few little things here for you. We had the outreach ministry yesterday was working, and we were able to hand out over 100 bags of food. Each bag, by the way, serves a family of four for 3 days. So we were really blessed to be able to help the community with that. And if you'd like to give any offering to a church, just go to that our website, the lagocc.org. Go to the top right-hand corner, click on that little tab that says donations, and then go to online giving. And we'll be happy to accept any offering that you'd like to give. And as Kimmy mentioned, we'd also talk about the prayer requests. And every time we have a service, we always ask for you to pray for all these brothers and sisters who are in need of prayer. And it says that a righteous man or person that their prayer is effective and powerful. So it's important for you to speak to the King of Kings for your brothers and sisters who might be in a valley at the moment. So here's a list of our brothers and sisters who are in need of your prayer. Carol Sykes will be having a surgical procedure on Tuesday, April the 13th. Karen Brooks' brother, Tyrone Mosley Sr., passed away unexpectedly on March the 30th. Steve McGibbon's 92-year-old father, Victor McGibbon, recently passed away. Darius Teal has been hospitalized. Phyllis Dumas had a total knee replacement on March the 9th. And Michael Nelson needs continued prayer for his medical condition. So we just ask you to, like, once again, lift all of those people up in your prayers. Also, if you'd like for us to pray for you, if you just go to the church's website and go to update church news, click on that little tab there, and you can put in your prayer so we can pray for you. And it can be corporate, where the whole congregation sees it and the whole congregation prays for you, or you can have it just for the ministers. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Nalis. We will certainly keep our church members and their families in our prayers. We're certainly going to pray for them. Now let's go to Max Hernandez, who would be reading the scripture for this sermon for today.
So this scripture reading is going to be from Matthew 12:36 and 37. But I tell you that everyone will have to give account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Thank you.
Minister Hooper will be bringing today's sermon. It's titled The Power of the Word, God's Word, Your Word. Minister Hooper always brings it every Sunday, and so we're just so excited to receive the word from God.
Amen. Thank you so much, Kimmy. Thank you, praise team. Thank you for all that have a hand in this worship service today. We encourage you guys to join us every second and fourth Sunday. If you'd like to be a part of putting this worship service together, feel free to contact me. We could certainly use your help and absolutely can use your prayers. We're planning on expanding to more than two Sundays a month. We expect within the next 2 months or so, bringing a live audience back. So I'm excited about that. We have been in a series, and the latest series that we've been in is The Power of the Word. So let me quickly recap the last two sessions of this series. This is a short series, probably a 3 week. I might go one more week with this series, but The Power of the Word, the first session was taken from Genesis 1, 3 through 26, where over and over and over again, God said, let there be, whether it was light, let there be man, whatever it may be, and it was so. Just with the spoken word, just think of the power of that. I don't want to re-preach that sermon again. Then the second message was our words, and our words have power as well. And it was taken from James 3, 9 through 11. With our tongues, we praise God, but also with those same tongues, we then curse man. We need to be careful what comes out of it. And if we're praising God, the likelihood of us cursing man isn't that great. So we need to focus on praising God. Today's message, though, is God's word, our word. Think about that. God's words, our word. Matthew 12, 36 through 37, which Max just mentioned, was, but I tell you that everyone will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word that they have spoken. Think about that. But I tell you that everyone will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word that they have spoken. For by your words, you'll be acquitted, and by your words, you will be condemned. That is a powerful verse. That's a powerful passage. Think about that. Everyone will have to give an account for every, not some empty words, for every empty word. Now, then James 3:8 says, but no human being can tame their tongue. So, and James is telling us that we can't tame our tongue. And in Matthew, it's saying that we're going to have to give account for all those words that come out of our untamed tongue. So sounds like we're in a quandary. We're in a tough spot. What do we do? How do we do that? See, we cannot tame our tongues. That is true. We cannot. But guess what? The Holy Spirit can. See, we have to let the Holy Spirit be the guiding rudder of our tongue and of our words. We have to ask the Holy Spirit to indwell us, to fill our hearts with prayer, to fill our hearts with scripture, so that those are the words that are coming out. Bow with me this morning as I pray just that. Lord God Almighty, I pray that the Holy Spirit indwell each and every one of us, dear Lord, so that the words that come out of us are your words, dear Lord, that you are the guiding rudder of our lives, dear Lord. May the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sights, dear Lord. We cannot do that on our own. We need you, dear Heavenly Father. We need you to take over us, to indwell us, dear Lord, so that whenever we're bumped, whenever we say anything, you come out of us, not us, dear Heavenly Father. I pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So today's message is how we can at least practice taming our tongues, thus being prepared to give an account of those words. As I said, we have to allow the Holy Spirit to indwell us. And I'm going to talk about how we need to invite the Holy Spirit into us, of course, through prayer. Now, at the end of every one of my sermons, I usually give you some sort of practical application so that you can put into play the message that I'm sharing with you that day. But I'm going to do that in the beginning. I'm going to prepare you on how to take notes so that you're able to implement these practical applications immediately. I'm going to give you five categories that I want you to memorize scripture under. And as I give you these five categories, and I'll get into how I want you to do this in a minute, but I want to give you these five categories first. And I love quotes, so with each category, I'm going to give you a quote. So the five categories that I'm going to be talking about today is, first, don't tear down. Don't tear one another down. Blowing out someone else's candle won't make yours shine brighter. And then inspire will be the second one. This is a scripture. Iron sharpens iron. We have to sharpen one another. Then the third one is listen. Listen not to respond, but to understand. The fourth one is from the heart. For both good and bad, the most powerful channel of communication is from the heart. And then the fifth one is praise God. In every situation, in every action, in every day, in every breath, praise God. So I hope you have your pens out, your pencils, your tablets, whatever it may be. As I said, we're going to go through those five categories, and I'm going to give you five scriptures, five passages of scriptures for each one of those. So you're going to get 25 scriptures today. And believe me, I won't keep you long, though, but you're going to have 25 scriptures today. This is what I want you to do in each one of those categories. I want you to take one of those scriptures, whatever the Holy Spirit places on your heart, and say that you're going to commit this to memory. So at the end, you won't be memorizing 25 scriptures. You'll be hearing 25. But at the end of the day, you'll choose, or the Holy Spirit will choose for you, five scriptures that I want you to memorize. Five scriptures. One scripture be to memorize under don't tear down, and one under inspire, one under listen, one from the heart, and one from praising God. And then as we're memorizing scripture, sometimes it's not just having the scripture memorized, but as we go through the process of memorizing scriptures, God is speaking to us. So as we go through it, I encourage you to go through the practice of memorizing scriptures so that as we're bumped, we're putting that into us. And when we're bumped, what comes out of us are those scriptures. Now, you may not know what that phrase is. I don't know if my wife coined this or not, but since I'm up here and I have the mic, I will give her credit for coining this phrase. So she talks about being bumped. She even has spoken to the Women's Fellowship and a couple of other groups about being bumped. When we are bumped, what's in us comes out. You know, when you stub your toe on the dresser in the middle of the night, what comes out? Don't answer. I hope the Holy Spirit comes out and not something else. But think about it. If somebody bumps into you, and you're holding a cup of water, what spills out? Water. And what do you say? Oh, no big deal. It's only water. But if you have coffee or a milkshake or a green tea tango smoothie and you're bumped and it spills on you, oh, yeah, that's what comes out. So what's important is what's in. So when you're bumped, you're not worried about being bumped. The Holy Spirit will come out of you. So we want the Holy Spirit to be in us. So when we're bumped, the Holy Spirit comes out. Have you ever been bumped by someone and you find yourself apologizing? If you bump, you're like, oh, no problem. My bad. That's the Holy Spirit. And then have you ever been bumped and something else has come out? And because we're so subject to the evils of the world or the evils of the world of other people, we have to guard our hearts, our tongues, and our mouths against the evils of the world by, again, allowing the Holy Spirit to be indwelled within us. As I said, I'm going to give you 25 verses. But before we do, and before I go into the first one of Don't Tear Down, I got a video that I promise you I would show a video each week of our buddy Leon. And as we know, Leon, and just to set this up for some of you who haven't seen, the quality of the video is not that great. This is from the early 2000s. But this character's fine. He says everything that we shouldn't say. So even in this video, I want to set it up. Leon starts out okay, but you know Leon's not going to stay okay for too long. So listen how he even tears someone down while it appears that he's building them up. So let us look at this video at this time.
Leon, you sign a record contract in the offseason. You come in with great numbers, Hall of Fame caliber numbers. But since then, disappointment. Your numbers are down. Who's to blame?
Well, Chuck, in this situation, I first have to look at myself.
The great ones do.
Right. So since you and I both know that can't be it, I gotta blame the fans and the media. And after that, it's the lineman's fault, it's the coach's fault. It can be your fault, Chuck.
You know, and that's how some of us do it. You know, we start out, I got to look at myself. Can't be me, though. It must be everyone else. But anyway, let's get into this. So the first one is don't tear down. Don't be a Leon. I'm going to give you five verses, And as I go through it, I'm going to go through them somewhat quickly, but then I'll recap them so you can jot them down. And as I'm giving you the verses, ask the Holy Spirit, which one of these verses do you want me to use for my life? So the first one is Colossians 4:6. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Is that the verse for you? Let your conversation be always filled with grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. And sometimes that just may mean your presentation. And then the second one is Ephesians 4:29. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building up according to the needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Leon needed to pray this one and take this one in. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths. And then the third one is Proverbs 15:1. Actually, the whole passage is Proverbs 15:1-4, but I'm encouraged if you choose this one to memorize at least the first verse. And it says, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. So sometimes just giving that gentle word will keep you from tearing someone down, but that harsh word can build up anger in someone else. So that's Proverbs 15:1. Let me read the rest of that from 4. It says, the tongue of the wise commands knowledge, but the mouth of the fool gushes folly. The eyes of the Lord are everywhere, keeping watch on the wicked and the good. There's that accountability that we got to give account for every empty word. The tongue that brings healing is a tree of life, but a deceitful tongue crushes the spirit. Our tongue can crush the spirit of people, even when we don't know that's what we're doing. You can tear someone down just by the words that you're saying, and it creates deep scars and deep wounds that you don't even see. The fourth one is Proverbs 27:20. Guard your words, mind what you say, and you will be able to keep yourself out of trouble. This one may be about not tearing yourself down. You know what? You might need to guard your words. No, not might. We need to guard our words, mind what we are saying, so that we can just keep ourselves out of trouble. And then the fifth one in this category is Proverbs 18:21. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. Just out of our tongue, we can kill somebody's dream. We can kill their spirit. Death can come from the tongue. You know, it can even be literal when you are testifying in a court. You can send someone to jail. That's how powerful that tongue is. But even when you're just putting someone down, I've heard stories of someone that said someone insulted them when they were 8 years old or 10 years old, or my mom said this to me, or my dad always called me some sort of name, and they're 60 years old remembering how daddy crushed their spirit, how their friend or their cousin, their relative crushed their spirit. So life and death is truly in the tongue. So if you're unable to keep up with that, I'm going to give you all of the scriptures again. Just jot these down. And then go back and read them and pray about which one you want to invoke. If you have the outline, they're already there. But it was Colossians 4:6, Ephesians 4:29, Proverbs 15:1, Proverbs 27:20, and Proverbs 18:21. So we move on to the second category, inspire. And I'm going to repeat some of these verses. So we're going to go to Proverbs 18:21 again. What was that? Life and death is in the power of the tongue. So with tearing down, I talked about the death piece of it. But think about it. You can bring life to someone by an encouraging word, by inspiring them. So life, give life instead of death, just by the word of what you are saying to them. Build them up, inspire them. Iron sharpens iron, life and death. But now I'm saying choose life by what you say through your words and through your tongue. The second one's a repeat again, Ephesians 4:29. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths. A lot of times as preachers, we just focus on that piece of it. I want to focus in this category under the second part, but only what is helpful for building up according to their need, that it may benefit those who listen. So listen to their needs, not your needs, to their needs. Inspire them. Sit there and say, you know what? I believe they need to hear this inspiring word from me. They need to hear this encouragement from them, and I'm going to share it with them so that it benefits them. Not benefits me, but benefits them. And then the third one, 2 Timothy 4:2. Preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage, and here's the most important of this, with great patience and careful instruction. So don't look at this and say, I'm not a preacher. You are. If you're a child of God, you are a preacher. You're called to share the word of God and preach his word in your daily lives and in your words. Correct, rebuke. Yes, correct people. Yes, rebuke people. And of course, encourage them. But what? How are we to do that? With great patience and careful instruction. Sometimes we're real quick to want to give advice. We're real quick to rebuke. We're real quick to correct. But here in this scripture, it says, do it, but do it with great patience. Do it with careful instruction. And then we'll jump over the fourth one, Matthew 28:19-20. And think about this one. Stay with me for a moment on this one. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the end of the age. God has given us this great commandment, telling us that we are to share the gospel. What an inspiring message. To tell somebody you can have eternal life and sharing with them that the life here on earth is so temporary, but you have eternity, especially this season of COVID with the thousands and thousands of deaths. How you can inspire somebody by sharing with them that it's something better than our short time here on earth. What a way to inspire somebody. And then the fifth one, Hebrews 3:13, but encourage one another daily as long as it's called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. But again, encourage one another daily. Is that the scripture that you need to remember? I need to encourage someone daily. So again, you're going to look at all five of these in each of this category. Ask the Lord, which one of these do you need me to memorize? Some of you might go the extra mile, those overachievers, and say, I'm going to memorize all of them. And praise be to God if you do. But don't memorize it just to memorize it. Memorize it because the Holy Spirit is telling you, this is what I want inside of you. So that when I'm bumped, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to encourage you. When I'm bumped, I'm not going to tear you down. I'm going to build you up. So recap those if you didn't catch them all under inspire. Proverbs 18:21, Ephesians 4:29, 2 Timothy 4:2, Matthew 28:19, and then Hebrews 3:13. Now this one is probably one of the hardest ones that we have, and it's listen. So as we move into the third category, listen, listen. Remember the quote I gave you was listen to understand, not to respond. Usually we want to listen because I can't wait to give them this great advice. I can't wait to tell them how wrong they are, opposed to just listening to try to understand and asking questions. So this is a verse that I use every single day for probably the last 2 or 3 years. I'm going to expound a little bit more on it, but basically I pray this prayer as a part of my prayer every day. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. So this is 1 Samuel 3:9. So Eli told Samuel, go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lied down in his place. I'm trying to give you a backdrop of that story real quick. Samuel was sleeping and he kept hearing his voice. And he would go to Eli and say, what do you want? And Eli said, I don't want anything. And he went back again. Eli said the same thing. He said, wait a minute. God is speaking to you. See, God may be speaking to you. God may be speaking to me, but we don't recognize his voice and we're not listening. So this might be the verse for you. Even if you just memorize that one part, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. The second one in this category on the listen is James 1:19. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. I think we're completely opposite in this world. Listen is the last one. We're very quick to speak, and then we speak, and then they're not listening to us, so we become angry. But you know what? We need to be quick to listen. Wow, let me hear what you're saying. Talk to me. I don't understand. Give me more details. Be patient with them. Be slow to speak. Be slow to respond. And hence, I think by doing that, it'll be slower in anger. And then the third one, sin is not ended by multiplying words, but the prudent holds their tongue. That's Proverbs 10:19. Now, I'm guilty of this one. If you think about it, I'm going to put it in today's term. Sin is not ended by multiplying words. And I'm prudent. I listen to my families and listen to my wife and listen to my kids. And you know what this is saying? Stop lecturing. And I was a lecturer. And I remember someone saying, where has it gotten you? Have that changed the kids? Have that changed your wife? And I'm sitting there saying, well, no, the more I talk, the more they'll hear. And the more I talk, the more they shut down. And it says, sin is not ended by a multitude of words. And what I was doing, I was lecturing, I was just adding more words. Okay, you don't understand the first 100 words. And I said, let me add another 200 or 300 more words. You don't understand those 500 words. Let me add another 500 words. And I'm actually making it worse. So this is one that I think I'm going to start working on here. Proverbs 10:19. And I don't want to ask my wife because she might answer the way I don't. They say lawyers don't ask a question you don't know the answer to. I think I've gotten better, but I'm not going to ask her. The fourth one is answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own conceit. Answer a fool according to his folly, as his folly deserves, sharply and decisively, and in a language suited to his comprehension. Proverbs 26:5. Let me put it simple. Don't argue with a fool. Don't argue with a fool. You know, no matter what, and you know what? Apologize right here. Sometimes we all act like a fool on social media. And you're sitting there trying to argue it in writing and argue with this person on this side. And sometimes we just need to be slow to speak. Slow to speak. But even face to face, you know no matter what you say, you're not going to win them over. Understand just that. That's what's happening. And then the fifth one is Proverbs 12:15. Way of a fool. Right in his own eyes. But a wise man listens to advice. So this goes back to argue with a fool. A fool comes in, I already know it. I don't need any advice. Don't even need to hear it. So go ahead, argue all you want. You're not going to win me over because I've already made up my mind. But it says the wise man listens to advice. So I'm not going to ask, do you put yourself in the category of a fool? But do you put yourself in the category? I will ask this. Do you put yourself in the category of a wise man? Are you willing to listen? Even when they're saying something that you don't really want to hear, you definitely don't agree with, but you're willing to listen. Remember that verse said, be quick to listen. So those five that I want you to choose from, which one is for you that the Holy Spirit wants you to indwell within you and to memorize is 1 Samuel 3:9. James 1:19, Proverbs 10:19, Proverbs 26:5, and Proverbs 12:15. So now we move on to the fourth one. From the heart. From the heart. Luke 6:45. A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and an evil man brings up things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. This goes back to being bumped. What's in the heart is what's coming out. We need to work on what is stored up in our hearts. So if you're already sitting there saying, he wants me to memorize five verses, that's a lot. You know what? I'm talking about what we need to store up in our heart. We need to store up in that heart. We need to push out the evil. And you know what? Don't say that you're not evil, because we're human. We all have evil tendencies and aspects within us. So memorize it so that we're working on healing our heart. The second one is Romans 10:9-10. And think about it. It starts out, if you declare with your mouth. So we'll talk about the power of the word again, that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your hearts. So we're talking mouth and heart again, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. So this one might be just for you to build you up. You need to declare with your mouth and believe with your heart. And if that's a verse that you need to repeat over and over again, that I need to declare with my mouth and I need to believe with my heart. The third one in this category is, may these words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to the sight, to your sight, Lord, my rock and redeemer. You hear ministers pray that prayer quite often. And to be honest, I'm going to close with the conclusion with that in a little bit. And even that'll be part of my prayer. But guess what? That's not just for ministers. That's for every single one of us. You may want to say, I'm going to memorize this so that always the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart is pleasing in your sight, God. I think it's important that we do that from the pulpit, but it's important that we do that in every single thing we do. Because remember, we got to hold account for every empty word. But if we're asking God that the meditation of your mouth, or the words of your mouth and the meditation of your heart is pleasing to him, and then you get up there and have to be held accountable, God's saying, wow, you said this that was pleasing to me while you meditated on my word. So again, the importance of memorizing these scriptures. Then Proverbs 4:23, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. When you're bumped, it comes from the heart. That's why I go back to Psalm 19:14. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, because we want what's pleasing to God to come out of that heart. And then the fifth one was, but the things that come out of a person's mouth comes from the heart, and these defile them. That's Matthew 15:18. So recap of that, we have Luke 6:45, Romans 10:9-10, Psalms 19:14, Proverbs 4:23, and Matthew 15:18. So now we're in the final one, the fifth one. Praise God.
Yeah.
We are to praise God.
Yeah.
Psalm 34:1, I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I should probably just give you that one and walk away. Psalm 34:1, I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. The second one is, therefore, by him, let us continually offer sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of our lips, the fruit of our lips, praising God, giving thanks to his name. That's Hebrews 13:15. The third one in this category is praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to God. It is pleasant and praise is beautiful. And this is a power of even singing and singing those praises. And my wife's always singing praise songs and choruses, and it's power in those songs. You know, unfortunately, it's power in some of the evil songs and the negative songs with words and things like that. So what's in our hearts come out. So we need to be singing and humming those praise songs and those songs to the Lord, opposed to the secular music that's out there that's filthy. And we look in my generation, you know, I'm a 70s and 80s music guy, and we look at and we criticize the young people of the day of the music they listen to. But you know what? The music that we listened to in the 70s and the 80s weren't too much better. They weren't as explicit with the language, But the implications, I got to share, it was a movie that was out, I think it's called The Johnson's Family Reunion. Mm-hmm. And there's a scene in there where the young boy, the dad's throwing out all of the young boy's song music because of the violence and the explicit lyrics and et cetera, et cetera. So then the son does the same to the dad's old school music. And he was like, oh, this one's talking about adultery. Oh, this one's talking about killing. Oh, this one. So us in this baby boomer generation, we're no better than the generation of the day. So be careful when we're criticizing our children. But you know what? We don't have to worry about that if the praises of the Lord are coming from our lips. And that's Psalm 147:1. The fourth one, Psalm 136:1. We give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to them. Give thanks to the Lord. That's a way of praising him. And then the fifth one, because, and let me give you an explanation on the fifth one. So on the fifth one, I'm going back to Romans 10:9. That was actually a typo. So I put that in a typo. I was reviewing my notes yesterday. I said, you know, I need to get in early. I need to talk to the people in the screen booth. I need to make the correction here. I need to correct it here over there. That one should have been there. But then I said, you know what? That was an error on my part, but it may not have been an error on the Holy Spirit's part. Leave it as is. And that one is because if you with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Somebody needed to hear that. And that's why I said, leave it there. I'm going to say it again. You know, that is the biggest praise that you can give to the Lord, that you confess with your mouth that he is Lord and you receive him with your heart. So it's amazing what we think is a mistake is not a mistake. That God was saying they need to hear that one again. You need to hear that one again. So that could be the biggest praise. If you've never done that before, confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you haven't believed with your heart, that's the biggest praise that you can give the Lord. So I encourage you to do just that. So to recap the fifth category in praising the Lord, Psalm 34:1, Hebrews 13:15, Psalm 147:1, Psalm 136:1, and Romans 10:9. So I hope that you will look at each one of those. You'll look at those 25 verses that you have in your notes or check. The Holy Spirit may have already spoken to you. And I encourage you in a practical way, look in each category and say, you know, under tearing down, this verse I need to speak to me. In the category of inspiring, this verse needs to speak to me. I'm going to memorize this verse. Listening, I struggle with listening. This verse has spoken to me. Choose that verse. And then, of course, from the heart, which the heart is the biggest one. But the heart can be deceiving if we don't train it and build it up. Lord, indwell me with this verse so that when I'm bumped, it comes out and my heart is constantly getting stronger. And then whatever verse you need that will inspire you to praise the Lord, choose that one. And I just want, in conclusion, the verse that I picked here, as I said I was going to pick, Psalm 19:14, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Lord, you're my rock and my redeemer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you. Lord God Almighty, I ask that you just indwell us with your Holy Spirit. Bless us. Keep us strong, dear Lord. Help us to focus on our words so that they are not tearing people down, that we're listening and we're inspiring and building people up, and that when we're bumped, what comes out of our heart are you, dear Heavenly Father, not the evil of the word. Help us to praise you in all things, dear Heavenly Father. I ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen and amen. Thank you so much, Minister Hooper, for that wonderful sermon. I don't know about you, but I was really inspired. The Holy Spirit was certainly in this church and in this room, and hopefully, and I'm sure, in your home. And so I want to encourage you to take these verses, these Bible verses, and meditate on them during the week. There are five different categories. You can split them up. On Monday, you focus on The Bible verses associated with not tearing down with your mouth. On Tuesday, you can focus on the sermons. I mean, the Bible verses about inspiring others. Just really meditate on these Bible verses. And now I will like to introduce the praise team, who will provide a song titled The Blessing. This is one of my favorite benediction. It talks about a prayer about your over your family, over your household, over your generation. It's important to speak life into your family, to speak into your generation. And this song selection just moves me. And so let's hear from the praise team.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. inside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, He is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you.
Praise God. Praise God. He is for you. He is for you. Thank you, praise team. He is for you. I am convicted, but not ashamed. I am taking this word. Thank you, Minister Hooper. This was a timely series. God is good because I needed to hear that. And I'm going to tell you, when I'm bumped, everything good doesn't always come out. And I'm going to commit scripture and hide them deep in my heart. So when I'm bumped the next time, God's word is coming out. Holiness is coming out. Praise is coming out. Encouragement is coming out. I'm going to listen and not respond for understanding. So I thank God for that word. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Minister Hooper. And most importantly, thank you, God, for putting that on his heart to share with us. Really quickly, I just wanted to mention that we are going to have a new series coming up, The Love of Money. And I don't know about you, but I'm going to need that series too. So when you tune in next time with the Contemporary Worship Service, hopefully we will be listening to that new series that Minister Hooper will come forth with, and it will bless us all about money. Be blessed this week and take these five things with you.
The Bible speaks more about money than any other singular subject. Why do you think that is? Maybe because God knows what is often the course of our heart.
One of the most misquoted Bible verses is, "Money is the root of all evil." Nalas, would you like to elaborate on that for me, please?
Yeah, I would. 1 Timothy 6:10 says, "For the love of money is the root of all evil."
What do you think that means?
While money, by the way, is neither good nor bad, it's in itself, it's when we place it above God and we love it more than the things of God that gets us into trouble.
Join us April the 11th at the Contemporary Worship Service, 12:30, for Minister Hooper's series, "For the Love of Money." You will be blessed. Thank you.